Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/spookshow. Then go over to morbidlybeautiful.com as we are now part of the Morbidly Beautiful Podcasting Network. Hello and welcome back to the All-American Spook Show podcast. I'm Josh and I'm joined here with Donnie.
Yo.
Tiana.
Hey.
And the Professor Smoot.
What's up?
We are going back to the Cannon Fodder well. This is our Cannon Fodder series where if you've never listened to it before, you need to go back and find all the Cannon Fodder episodes. But the whole point of this series is we go through the Cannon Films library. We literally have a huge list. We spin a wheel, whatever it lands on, that's what we're going to watch. It landed on one of the bigger Cannon films. We try off and on at least to avoid some of the bigger releases because we know there's so much smaller releases or worse movies that Cannon put out. But serendipity, right? It just keeps landing on some like halfway decent flicks, you know. And this was another one with Cobra from 1986, the Stallone classic. Because the last time we did Cannon Fodder was Missing in Action 2, The Beginning, right? Yeah, that was what that one was called, The Beginning. And then before that, we watched Braddock Missing in Action 3. So you got to go all the way back to episode 186 when we did The Frog Prince. The last time we had a straight ass Cannon movie. So we've been on a little bit of a higher end run of Cannon here lately. So, but hey, I'll take it. I'll take this over the Apple or Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hype or whatever the fuck any day of the week. So I'm cool with it.
With the two, what'll suck is when... If the wheel keeps picking all the great ones, then we're stuck with all the shit ones at the tail end.
Yeah.
It'll be worth it, you know, thankfully. But
yeah, which I guess is my point is we might have to supersede the wheel next time around. Like, we can't let it land on another good one.
We
need to force the issue. Yeah. We might need to keep spinning until it lands on some shit so we can make sure that we keep, so we keep the good ones at bay a little longer because I'm telling you, you watch a bunch of like the Apple type movies over and over, you're just like, fuck this, we're done. You know, so we gotta keep it sane, right? For us to keep enjoying this. To this point, I've definitely enjoyed this series and we highly recommend you go back and check them out. It's generally on average about every, what, six episodes or so, Donnie, like give or take whenever we do this because of our rotation. So there might be some bigger gaps during the summer events and stuff like that. But by and large, if you go back about 6-7 episodes, you'll see the latest Cannon Fodder. So those are all in the podcast archives, which you can access by going to aaspookshow.com. Call that the center of the Spook Show universe. And also from there, you can find our YouTube channel, where every month we have series like Grindhouse Gutter, Video Vortex, Hammer Horror in Order. So those are a lot of fun. We do those every week, every month. And of course, we encourage you to become a patron of the Spook Show by going into patreon.com/aaspookshow. And every month you'll get a video mini-sode, including the Library of the Professor, and you'll get Crafterpiece Theater, the much forlorn series for us, but loved by the listeners. And those are available every month. And the whole backlog, I think there's been about 25 or 26 episodes of Crafterpiece Theater, believe it or not, that are over there on Patreon. So patreon.com/aaspookshow. So without any further buildup, we'll go ahead and toss to the trailer.
Society is breeding a new kind of criminal. It's also breeding a new kind of cop. Meet Cobra. He does the job nobody wants.
Did you use unnecessary deadly force?
I used everything I had.
Do you know you have an attitude problem?
Yeah, but it's just a little one. You think you would recognize me if you saw him again?
The tall one?
Yeah. The one that wants to kill you.
Do what you have to do to get a lead on this maniac.
And if I find him?
Do what you do best.
Thank you.
Stallone is Cobra, the strong arm of the law.
So there you go. Crime is the disease, and now we're finally going to meet the cure. And that is Marion Cobra Cobretti. Before we start taking our deep dive into it, though, as every time we have a Cannon Fodder episode, we always have a Cannon Chronicles segment with author Austin Trunick, who literally is probably the world's foremost expert. I'd find it hard to believe that there are too many people on this planet that have done as much research and know as much shit about Cannon films than Austin Trunick, because he wrote two full books, The Cannon Film Guide Volume 1 and Volume 2, which you can find on Amazon and various other places you buy your books. So we encourage you to go buy his books, because this dude is a vast, infinite well of information into the history of Cannon films. So if you're listening to this and you're interested in Cannon at all, that's where you can get it. So without further ado, we'll go ahead and toss to Austin for his latest Cannon Chronicles.
Cannon Chronicles with Austin Trunick.
Hello, Spookshow listeners. Austin Trunick here, author of the Cannon Film Guide books. Today, I'm going to say a few words about the Sylvester Stallone classic Cobra from 1986. This is a movie that I really only cover a small amount in my second volume, because it technically isn't a canon movie. It is, but it isn't. It's in this sort of weird space that a lot of 1980s classics, in my opinion, find themselves in, where it wasn't really an in-house film. It's something they ended up with their name on in a very roundabout way. Now, this one came about because in 1984, Cannon signed this huge, massive news-making deal with Sylvester Stallone to make the film Over the Top, the arm wrestling, truck driving, father-son bonding movie that everybody loves. It's another Sylvester Stallone mid-80s classic. But this contract was for $12 million, and it was at the time the most a single actor was ever paid for one film. He was breaking records at the time with this. And the problem for Cannon was that Cannon, if you know anything about them, if you've been following on to previous episodes, they're not the kind of company that had $12 million just sitting around, sitting in a vault, sitting in a bank anywhere. They're a company that if they ever had $12 million, they would use it to make three movies. For $12 million, they could make a ninja movie, they could make a Charles Bronson movie, and they'd probably also squeeze in some fairy tale adaptation for children, and that would all be $12 million. But instead, this was just going to Sly. This money wasn't even going to cover the budget of the film. So part of this deal was that it was also an exclusive. That was a big deal. They took out two-page ads in Variety day after day saying, welcome Sylvester Stallone to the Cannon family in this exclusive contract. It was all over the trade papers at the time. And in reality, Sly actually just took a $500,000 payment and an IOU for the other 11.5 whenever Cannon raised it. And he promised them that when he finished up his next couple movies, Cannon would be next in line to make the movie that they wanted to make with him, which was Over the Top. So in 84, 85, he made Rambo 2, he made Rocky 4, and it came time for him to make Over the Top. But the thing was, Cannon still didn't have the money. They didn't have the money to pay him. They didn't have money to actually shoot the film. And at the time, Warner Brothers wanted to make Cobra, which is a in a very kind of wacky story, was Sly's rewrite of Beverly Hills Cop. He wanted to take all the humor out and make his own version. He wanted to make this movie. Warner Brothers wanted to make this movie. Unfortunately, Cannon had the rights to make his next film. So they came to an agreement between Warner Brothers and Cannon. Warner Brothers would help pay for Over the Top, the movie that Cannon wanted to make, but didn't have the cash to do so. And Cannon would step aside so that Warner Brothers could make Cobra with Sly. They would say, okay, you know, we're going to let him around his exclusive, quote-unquote, contract to do this. So that's really how this happened. He got to make Cobra then. It was obviously very much a project that was very Sly driven. Everything from having his script to him starring to co-starring with his then wife, Brigitte. And it's a wild movie. I do enjoy Cobra a lot. Part of the deal, though, with Cannon, part of the to save face after they've been spending all this money on newspaper advertisements saying that we have the exclusive deal with Sly Stallone, Warner Brothers promised that they would put them on as producers. So it's really just a vanity credit. Golden Globe as Cannon had nothing to do with the movie other than stepping aside to let Sly do it, accepting some money from Warner Brothers for doing so, and getting their names put on it. So that is why I don't really get too much into the production of this film in my books. It's Cannon were outsiders looking in. They didn't have that much to do with the movie, much more than you or I do. But it is a great movie. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love, love, love Cobra. And I'm as my rating, I'll get out of the way, I'm going to give it a perfect 5. Because even if it's not a Cannon movie, this is a perfect 1980s action film. You get some incredible lines. You get a great villain performance from Brian Thompson. You have Sylvester Stallone eating pizza with scissors. They're the weirdest way to eat a pizza, but I mean, I can't say that I haven't aped that behavior when eating pizza since, just because I think it makes me look cooler. Makes me look a little bit like Marion Cobretti. I mean, what a name, Marion Cobretti, too. I love that his character has this, you know, this quote unquote girl's name. It's awesome. Sly doesn't get enough credit as a screenwriter. I mean, other than Oscar nominations and things like that, but specifically enough credit as a screenwriter on all of his kind of wild, insane, brainless action movies, which we all love so much. But there we are, Cobra. I hope you guys have fun discussing the movie. I hope you have fun out there in Radioland listening to the fellas talk about this amazing, amazing piece of over-the-top 80s action. And until next time, folks, I'm Austin Trunick, and I will see you all later.
All right, there you go. That's that. As always, deep, deep knowledge, behind-the-scenes stuff, some stuff you may or may not know about Cobra and any other Cannon flicks. Every time we do a Cannon Fodder, we have Austin on, so we thank Austin for that. But I guess so we can get into the movie itself, we'll go ahead and take our own little deep dive into some of the background information. I've got, Smoke, you might be interested, I've got a few various alternate titles for this movie. Now, one, I'm not sure, this was in Austria and Germany, so I'm not sure if this is like a translation type thing or what, but it was called Die City Cobra. And in Brazil, it was just called, and this is awesome because let's just state the obvious, it's called Stallone Cobra.
That's nice. We're going to make sure that not only is the poster going to say who is starring, but the title of the film is going to also say who is starring.
Yeah, Stallone Cobra. And in Hungary, it was known as A Cobra, but like Cobra with a K. But A Cobra is the name of the movie there. It was released domestically and throughout the world wide May 23rd, 1986. It was, of course, and this is the main reason we're here today, produced by the Cannon Group. But this was actually distributed by Warner Brothers. So this was one of the ones that they did not distribute themselves. And they had a number of those during this time period where they had some deal worked out with Warner Brothers. So that's how they were able to do that. It got wider distribution, I'm sure, because of that. At least more money in the machine to make it and to get behind the press of it and everything, for sure, with having Warner Brothers involved. And, of course, I'm sure that was a big reason why they got Stallone in general, which is because of the big money behind it, right? Of course, if you've ever seen this, and by the way, before we continue, this might be a good spot to tell you, if you've never listened to us before, we are a spoiler-filled podcast. So if you have not seen Cobra, we highly recommend it. I'd say that right out the gates.
Oh, yeah.
But you should, because we're going to spoil the fuck out of it if you haven't. So go ahead and pause it. Go watch Cobra in various methods and then come back and listen to the rest of this. But if you've ever seen this before, you know this is true. This movie is rated R. Very R. Total runtime is 1 hour and 27 minutes. That's the sweet spot for movie runtimes for me. On IMDb, it's listed as an action crime thriller. It was filmed in various spots around the Los Angeles, California area from October 23rd of 1985 to January 17th of 1986 for a budget get this, Donnie, of $25 million, which is really fucking high for a Cannon movie, right? Like,
yeah, no doubt, right?
Notoriously, like, they made movies for $1 million or so, you know? So, like, obviously, I'm sure a huge chunk of that was Stallone, right? And the fact that he wrote it and everything. So, I'm sure a lot of that budget went there. And it's not like it's this CGI fest or something like that where you would see all the money. I mean, I think you see the money kind of on the screen and the quality of it, but I think mostly they're probably paying the Stallone premium and that $25 million. But it did go on. It was successful. It went on to make worldwide gross of $49 million. So I'd say that did pretty well. I've got the top 10 in the box office from that weekend of, and this was actually Memorial Day weekend. If you know, if you kind of spread it out to like the 4-day weekend, this was the Memorial Day weekend in 1986. So it was May 23rd through the 26th. So here's the top 10. Sorry. Number 10, Gung Ho. Number 9, Pretty in Pink. Number 8, Down and Out in Beverly Hills. Number 7, Police Academy 3, Back in Training. Number 6, JoJo Dancer, Your Life is Calling. Number 5, Sweet Liberty. That's the one that sticks out like, what the fuck? I don't remember that movie, but there it is. Number 4, Short Circuit. Number 3, Top Gun. Number 2, Poltergeist 2, The Other Side. That's right. There was a week in history where Poltergeist 2 beat out Top Gun. It was Memorial Day weekend, 1980, which is also weird, too, right? You think everybody would be like, oh, fuck, Top Gun. It's Memorial Day. Let's go. No, Poltergeist 2 beat it out. And what beat everything out? The opening weekend of Cobra. It made $15.6 million. Stallone and all the rest, they were loving that shit. Loving life. Memorial Day weekend, 1986. This movie was written by, the screenplay was written by Sylvester Stallone, but it was based on a novel called A Running Duck by Paula Gosling. And then the novel actually got retitled later on when it got re-released as Fair Game. So you may have seen the book as A Running Duck or as Fair Game, because I think they actually made a different movie later in the 90s called Fair Game based on the novel as well. So I haven't seen that. I'm not really, you know, up to speed on that one. I would just be interested to see how similar it is to this, although I'm sure it's not even half as entertaining as fucking Cobra. But apparently it was similar enough to that novel that they actually had to give her a writing credit because I guess he had lifted so heavily from the novel. So you do see her name in the writing credits there. But the screenplay was written by him. It was directed by George P. Cosmatos. And he would, you may or may not recognize his name from Rambo First Blood Part 2, Leviathan, and Tombstone, much later in the 90s. Unfortunately, he's no longer with us. He passed away in 2005. But he definitely left a mark, you know, among those titles, and there was a handful of other movies that you've probably seen or heard of.
We take a point here to mention, although he's no longer with us, his son is Panos Cosmatos, and he's making modern movies that you may have heard of. Mandy, that one, and Beyond the Black Rainbow.
You know, you mentioned that. I knew his name was familiar. I didn't make that connection, but I knew his name was familiar from when we did Mandy. That you're right.
Yeah.
So some good pedigree over there in the old Cosmatos household.
Yes. Right? You can almost. I'm not saying that there's anything necessarily related to Mandy and Cobra, but there is a little bit of something there that's just that style of. I don't know. I can see a little bit of his dad, I guess, in him in that. You know, not that he's taking anything from Cobra, but there's just a little bit of similarities of style or something, I guess.
Well,
I
don't know. If you remember Mandy correctly, there was an axe, and there's plenty of axes in this movie, so there's something there. Who knows? This movie was produced by, of course, Golan and Globus. You know, that's the Cannon group. It stars Sylvester Stallone as Marion Cobra Cobretti. Now, you know, we really don't need to take much of a deep dive into Sylvester Stallone. I'm sure if you've watched a movie over the last 50 years or heard about the movie business, you know the name Sylvester Stallone, Rambo, Rocky. You can just stop there, but you don't have to. You can keep going. There's tons of movies this dude has done over his career. We'll go down as one of the legends of Hollywood for sure. It also stars Brigitte Nielsen as Ingrid. Now, they had met, Stallone and Brigitte Nielsen had met when they made Rocky IV, I guess a year or two prior to this, and then they got married, right? They were married for a small amount of time. I think they were actually married when they did this movie. And I'm sure that's the main reason that she's in it. And then apparently they split up not long after that. But
I think it was 87 they split up. I think I read.
So it's roughly a year or so after this movie comes out that they had split up, but they were a thing at this time. You may recall seeing Brigitte Nielsen in, and really this is probably the one thing, if you don't remember her from Rocky IV or this one, Red Sonja would probably be the place you would remember her from, right?
Yep. With co-starring a lot, I mean, well, she starred. The co-star of that one, I guess you could say, which is kind of odd for it being sort of a co-star, is Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
Playing Conan, only not Conan, because the same studio didn't own the rights or whatever, so that I don't even remember what he was called in Red Sonja, but he was basically supposed to be Conan.
You know, and there's another connection here with Brigitte Nielsen is that she later on was in Beverly Hills Cop 2, and I'll explain what that connection is in a little bit more detail in just a moment. It also stars Renny Santoni as Gonzalez. You know, this is Cobra's partner. You may recall seeing him in Dirty Harry, the 80s classic comedy Brewster's Millions. And there was another one, actually, that he was in, too, another John Candy comedy, Summer Rental. He was in that, too. But he was in tons of, you know, smaller roles in tons of movies throughout the 80s and 90s, hell, into the 2000s. But unfortunately, he died just 4 years ago. He passed away in 2020. Andrew Robinson as Detective Monty. This is kind of the prick detective that's, I guess, not kind of like Cobra's boss, but really just like the dickhead detective that keeps kind of, I guess he's in charge of the investigation, so he keeps poking his nose in. The major connection there is Hellraiser, right? He was the dad in the first Hellraiser movie.
Jesus Whipped.
Yeah, there you go. He's the Jesus.
Jesus Whipped.
That's him. He was also, just like Renny Santoni was, he was in Dirty Harry, you know, 15 years or so prior to this. And
yeah, interesting that you mentioned that. I mean, Dirty Harry was an influence on Stallone writing this movie as well, just as much as the novel that we talked about that came from.
Yeah.
Dirty Harry was as much as an influence as the novel, if not more.
Having both these guys, but specifically Andrew Robinson from Dirty Harry, had to have something to do with that, right? You would think on some level.
I didn't read anywhere where he casted them specifically for that, but I bet so.
Yeah. It's on some level, it had to have had something to do with it. And Andrew Robinson, by the way, he was also in Child's Play 3 for Donnie. That's Donnie's connection there.
Fuck.
It also has Brian Thompson as the Night Slasher. And that's literally as he's credited. He has no real name. It's just the Night Slasher,
which is,
he has tons of small roles. I mean, even today, he's still active and stuff. But you may remember his face from The Terminator, you know, the original one. Mm-hmm. Donnie, this is one of yours. He was in Three Amigos. He's one of the guys in Three Amigos. And he was also in Fright Night Part 2. And in Lionheart as well. That was a Van Damme movie, right? Lionheart. Yeah. He was in that. This was awesome. Because I didn't catch it. I didn't catch it at all. And it must be a super small fucking cameo or something somewhere in there. And I'm sure there's more of a story there. Ron Jeremy. Ron Jeremy's in this he's in there somewhere and just says as an extra. And according to IMDb, it's uncredited. So you won't see his name in the credits, but apparently he's in there somewhere. Lord knows. It might be for 2 seconds in one of those montage scenes or something. I don't know, but.
Well, if we ever do Ghostbusters, he will be a connection on both Cobra and Ghostbusters because he's also an extra in Ghostbusters.
Honestly, he'll probably be connected to more than that as time goes on.
Oh, yeah. I think in the previous Cult Corner, not really a poll, but when we nominated movies, Tiana nominated Boondock Saints. He's in Boondock Saints as well.
It is interesting that you brought up.
I swear I do not follow the career of Ron Jeremy.
Yeah, it is it is interesting that you brought up a poll with Ron Jeremy.
Mm.
And Busters, because you know Bustin makes him feel good, I'm bet.
Yeah, well, probably. That's awesome. Probably. All right, well here's your deep connection to Beverly Hills.
What deep?
See, Now it just writes itself for the rest of the program. It's just fucking Ron Jeremy joke. The deep connection to Beverly Hills Cop, okay? Beverly Hills Cop was supposed to star Sylvester Stallone. And when they brought him in, he's like, nah, this shit's too funny. if I'm going to be in it, this shit needs to be deadly serious. You know, like, we need to up the kill count. We need to make this shit more serious, right? So he rewrites the movie. And then I guess, you know, one thing led to another, like, nah, this isn't the direction we want to go in. We're just going to go with Eddie Murphy, and then, you know, flipped it back to a comedy, and, you know, history was made, right? Well, apparently they took the outline and a lot of the script from Stallone's version of Beverly Hills Cop and turned it into this. So I guess his version of Beverly Hills Cop married with that novel by Paula Gosling is what we got here.
With Dirty Harry, like I said, you're like, yeah, you yeah. take Beverly Hills Cop, Dirty Harry, and the Paula Gosling novel, and yeah, that's Cobra, right?
Yeah, there you go. So that's why I find it ironic, swinging back, that Brigitte Nielsen, years after they had split, was in Beverly Hills Cop 2. So that maybe on some small level, that had to have been, you know, a fuck you sly move by her. Who knows?
Maybe.
Also, apparently, the original cut of this movie was give or take around 2 hours long. And I guess when they had edited it some to submit it for rating, it got an X rating. So then,
yeah, and that's, I'd love to see that cut.
Oh, that more of awesome. So they had to go in and actually edit it more. So this thing, like this final version that we see here is edited to pieces from apparently what it originally was intended to be. Now, I don't know if a director's cut got saved and exists somewhere, but I'd love to see it.
Yeah, me too. But like you were saying earlier on, like an hour and a half is a perfect running time.
Yes.
But I'd love to see that super long.
And that might be tipping our hand to what our ratings and final thoughts are going to be. But like, as awesome as this was, I'd love to see a much longer, more violent version of it.
Yeah. Because we were talking about that. I mean, and I've noticed it before, when, you know, me and Tiana, we were watching it. It plays out like a slasher movie. And the only thing missing from it is that extra gore, like, say, remember we did 10 to Midnight? 10 to Midnight was another very similar. It's got Bronson, action star, in a basically what is a slasher action movie.
Yeah.
We haven't done Silent Rage, but that's another one. Chuck Norris, another top-notch action star with a script that plays like a slasher movie. Mm-hmm. So there was something going on around this time, and what was going on with slasher movies being huge as well as action movies. So they just found ways to combine them, I guess.
That's probably what it was. Like, you know, slasher's popular, action movies are popular, let's find a way to marry them together. But also, like you said, you're probably in the beginnings of, if you're not dead in the middle of, the satanic panic crackdown on shit, right, too. So maybe they were also trying to find ways around, you know what, we still want to give people their gore and violence. Let's find a different way to do it.
Yeah, and that's very true. Like, a lot of those action movies and crime dramas got away with a lot more gore than even horror movies at the time. Like, there was probably more gore in the Martin Scorsese film from late 80s, and there wasn't horror movies in the late
80s. I can think of a lot of movies that we've talked about here on the podcast where this movie's probably gorier and more violent than a lot of movies that we watch from a similar time period. So yeah, there's probably something to it. But apparently, though, ironically, they edit the shit out of this thing, and there is the TV version, which I'm sure was edited for content purposes, right? Like, you know, let's take out some of the violence and words and, you know, all that language. But the TV version is actually 6 minutes longer than the theatrical cut. So I think they added more of the,
characterization.
Yeah. Some more of the, you know, that type of stuff into it to pad the runtime for, you know, I guess to get a 2 hour block with commercials out of it. So they actually had to pad the runtime of this thing and add 6 minutes of that stuff back in, but I'm sure they didn't add any gore whatsoever. But yeah, I'd love to get my hands on if it exists out there in some form. Sly, if you're listening, give us the director's cut of Cobra, because if anybody's got it, it's Sly, right? he would probably be the one that's got it if it does exist.
Although you would almost think that he would put it out there by now if he had it.
You would think, but, you know, because they did eventually come out, and I haven't seen it yet, but he did actually make a director's cut of Rocky IV. I don't know if y'all were ever tuned to that.
No, I've not seen it.
I haven't seen it, but that did come out, like, within the last few years or so. He went back and cut it, because apparently, like, his vision for it wasn't what the studio's vision. Like, remember Rocky IV, there's all the weird shit with Paulie, like, kind of having a sexual relationship with a robot and shit like that. Apparently that wasn't him. That wasn't Stallone's vision for it. Like, I know that as one fun
as those as that is.
Yeah, yeah. I think that was one of the things he went like, "This is stupid," and cut it out. You know, and some other shit. But yeah, it would be interesting to see his director's cut of that. But yeah, if it exists, I would imagine Stallone would probably have it. And if he does, please, please let us see that in some form or another. Also, another thing that I saw in was that Stallone apparently was pretty difficult to deal with making this movie. I think he was kind of at his height popularity wise. So his ego was running pretty high in this day, you know, in these 85, 86 when they're making this. So like,
yeah,
apparently he wasn't the easiest dude to get along with.
Yeah. So we're, I guess he didn't allow any of the supporting cast to talk to him at all.
I saw something about that. Yeah. Like, no, the old no, don't talk to me, no eye contact bullshit that you do sometimes. Now, apparently there was some of that where, like, when they were filming stuff, he would give attitude to the photographer or something. And somebody, it might have been the photographer or somebody eventually told him to go fuck himself. And then, in a roundabout way, right? They told him to go fuck himself. And then, like, apparently he just kind of laughed it off and, like, actually started, you know, taking it more seriously after that. But... yeah, but apparently then eventually he kind of reverted back to being an asshole again. So apparently he was, you know, by many accounts that I could see, he was not the easiest dude to deal with on this. But he did contribute the car. That 1950 Mercury that's in there, that's his car.
Yeah, with the license plate, Awesome 50.
Yeah. It's like AWSOM or something, Awesome 50. But apparently that is his car, although they had three or four stunt cars. So, like, obviously they didn't kick the shit out of his real life, you know, 1950 Mercury. But apparently they took, like, the guts of, like, I guess just piece of shit cars and then, like, put a shell over it and made dummy cars for, you know, a lot of the car chase and the stunt work and all that type of shit. But, yeah, that was actually his car. Smoke, I'm sure this was one of your favorite parts of the movie, the soundtrack.
Yeah, actually, I do love it.
Yeah. Very, very.
That's not sarcastic.
Yeah, no, no. I mean, it, you know, for 80s movies, I mean, it's some catchy shit, right?
Yeah. Oh, I'm a sucker for 80s movies, even when they are, even when it does have a cheesy, you know, whatever main theme song or whatever it is. But yeah, no, this one's what, Robert Tepper, Angel of the City.
Yeah. Anytime you can pull, like, Gladys Knight and the fucking Miami Sound Machine up with Robert Tepper and some other dudes. Yeah.
Yeah. That was a time. I mean, that was the '80s was of course the king of the montage, the era of the montage.
Oh yeah. You get Angel of the City.
Yeah. A lot of that, those sounds, you know, like Rock Till You Drop from the Monster Squad, right?
Yep.
Thunder in Your Heart from Red or whatever, you know, all these.
We'll get into songs. The montage. We'll get into that a little bit. Cause yeah, you had to have one in the mid-'80s, man. It was like, there's no movie that could get away. Even like probably a serious drama had some small montage scene in it back then.
That's just you had the right song for it.
For kids that, you know, for people that were younger and didn't grow up in that era. See, that's how we passed the time, was we lived in montages. That's how we noted the passage of time, was we just montaged everything.
It's so much so now that if you see a montage in a film, it's basically just a direct. They're just trying to evoke the 80s.
Yeah. And into the 90s too. Remember, I always remember when we watched Popcorn. Remember, there was a couple. There was the big montage scene there. Made it even into the 90s in some movies. But to the
I don't know what it is, but definitely into the 90s, right? Into the early to mid 90s, yeah, maybe somewhere in there.
Then it kind of died. But there was one song though that was actually originally written. This is so weird to me. There was a song that was originally written for Cobra, but for one reason or another, I guess they decided not to put it in there. And that was a song that eventually got used for Transformers, the movie, called The Touch by Stan Bush. You got the touch. That was written for Cobra. What the fuck? Apparently Stan Bush, what I saw, had some inspiration for, like, yeah, like when I'm writing the song, I thought of Stallone and this character and everything, but like, why they didn't use it, I don't know. Maybe it was even too corny or over the top for them to use it.
Over the top.
There you go. See, maybe I don't know what the reasoning was, but yeah, they decided not to use it for Cobra, and then eventually put it in Transformers. And remember, it was in Boogie Nights, right? And
yeah,
it's been re-recorded and made and put in various other movies. But yeah, that was made for Cobra. I was surprised by that because it just doesn't fit to me. I hear that song, I think of Transformers, and that's it.
Yeah.
And then I get sad because Optimus Prime died.
Mm.
Yeah, I mean, not to turn this into the Transformers the movie review, but that was a pretty heavy movie for a kid.
Oh yeah. We'll have to have a cult corner or something where we watch Transformers the movie just so we can have some therapy. We can talk it out. We can have some therapy 35 years later because it still makes me sad. This actually was nominated for various Razzie Awards. Surprise, surprise. But the main one was Worst Picture. It did get nominated for Worst Picture, but thank God it didn't win it. The winner, though, in 1986, it went to two movies. They split the winners, so two movies took the trophy that year because it was an especially shitty year, apparently. They gave the Razzie for Worst Picture to Under the Cherry Moon, that Prince movie, and Howard the Duck. Those beat out Cobra.
Well, thankfully, I couldn't imagine them giving the Razzie to Cobra over Howard the Duck.
Yeah. Well, that just shows you how bad it was, because I've never seen Under the Cherry Moon, but I've heard that movie sucks too. So,
I definitely missed that one too. I mean, Purple Rain's awesome, I think, but I never saw Under the Cherry Moon.
Yeah, I haven't heard anything good about it. So, Crapster Peace Theater, it's coming sooner or later. Cannon actually wanted to do a sequel to this. They intended to do it, but it just never happened. You know, one thing or another. And remember, the downfall of Cannon was, you know, just really just a few years into the future here anyway. So that's probably what eventually just, you know, died on the vine. Also in 2019, it was announced or, you know, made public that there was going to be a television series on Cobra and it was going to be made by Robert Rodriguez. But apparently that's not necessarily dead. There's just been no updates. So it might as well be dead, right? I mean, you're fast forwarding 4 or 5 years later, nothing. So it's probably dead, but that would be interesting, right? A series on Cobra from Robert Rodriguez.
Yep, definitely. Especially, I'm assuming it would have been on streaming or something where it could be, you know, uncut per se.
Yeah. Now I know at least at one time he had something, and I don't even know if it still exists. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. But I know for a while there was a channel, a network called the El Rey Network, and that was basically his network, Robert Rodriguez. So all he ended up showing all day was like old Kung Fu movies and, you know, all the shit that clearly influenced them, you know, but him and Tarantino. So it was that type of movies that they showed all the time. But they did have some series that they had on there. I think they had some type of Desperado type series or something that was on there. There was some other things, but maybe we see it. Maybe we don't. Who knows? That's still out in the ether, but that's a thing. But that I know that's a lot, but that's really about all the background stuff I had. I mean, did you guys have anything else you wanted to point out before we get into it?
I do.
Uh-oh. Breaking news.
We might get into it later, too, but what in the world was up with the plot for this? There was like a gang of people that were protecting the serial killer. That's what I get out of it.
You don't question the new world. I guess so. We like to hang out and bang our axes together at random intervals, all right?
I bet Ron Jeremy was in there banging his ass. Maybe that's a CD.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
Okay, that's enough Ron Jeremy. I gotta splash some water in my face or something.
Yeah.
Enough
Ron Jeremy. You need to go cool off, Professor.
It's intermission time. Time to pause and refresh at the snack bar. During this short break, you can treat your taste of good food and sparkling cold beverages, including delicious Coca-Cola. If you're hot dog hungry, we have them. Sizzling, juicy hot dogs served in warm, oven-fresh buns. Plus a complete menu of all your favorites. Visit the refreshment center now. Enjoy delicious food and ice-cold Coca-Cola.
For you, the listeners of the All-American Spook Show podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. So I went over to audible.com and typed in Cobra to see what would pop up. And wouldn't you know it, I got 156 results. Now, of course, these have nothing to do with this movie, but
things are all about snakes, right? Cobras.
I guess. I don't know. This one's called Cobra, the Cobra Trilogy Book 1 by Timothy Zahn. And that one is 10 hours long, and that's only from Audible. We've also got The Cobra by Frederick Forsyth. That one's 12 and a half hours long. And I'll scroll down just a little bit, and we've got Cobra by Dion Meyer. That's the Benny Grizzell mystery series, book four. And that one's over 10 hours long. So, yeah, it looks like a lot of series have something to do with Cobra. You know, obviously, it has nothing to do with this movie or Cobra from G.I. Joe, it doesn't look like. It's just something completely different. But if any of that floats your boat, and there, like I said, it was 156 results, go to audibletrial.com/spookshow. Again, that's audibletrial.com/spookshow for your free audiobook. Now I'm going to hop on over to imdb.com and click on plot summary if I can find it. Here it is. Let's see what we got. Donnie, hopefully there's a long one to explain things for you. All right, we got a few here, but nothing really long, so we're not going to torture you too hard this week. We've got the one-sentence one. A tough-on-crime street cop must protect the only surviving witness to a strange, murderous cult with far-reaching plans. There you go, Tiana. That's your explanation. It was a murderous cult with far-reaching plans. That's all you needed to know.
Yeah.
This one was submitted by Nick Reganis there on IMDb. It's a little longer. Criticized for his brutal and unconventional ways, hard-as-nails Lieutenant Cobra is the tip of the spear of LAPD's elite zombie squad. But crime runs rampant in the city, as a string of seemingly unconnected assaults on civilians drags the hardened officer into a violent war with the psychopaths of the New World, an underground cult aiming to weed out the weak. Cobra must escort key witness Ingrid to a safe house. However, the Night Slasher and the movement's delusional killers will stop at nothing to track her down. Now there is no turning back. Only one man stands in the way of the disease. Is the murderous cult prepared for swift justice and Cobra's deadly bite? Well, are they? I don't think so.
No.
I think that's the answer, Donnie. That's the proper answer. They're not ready for the cure. So we basically start like right at the beginning with these dudes clinking their axes together. And you see that a number of times randomly spursed and spliced into the movie. It's just they're hanging out in a foundry or something, and there's sparks and fire everywhere, and then there's just a bunch of sweaty dudes with axes just ching 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 ching. Cut it into the montages. It's just everywhere.
I think that axe cleaning was even in one of the songs, and it might not have been Angel of the City. It might have been Can You Feel the Heat or Feel the Heat or whatever. But yeah, it was in one of the songs. Yeah. The axe cleaning.
They just kind of worked it in. Ching ching. I guess that's their meetings. Their meetings just, you know, they open and adjourn with axe clingings. That's it. And in between, they talk about how they have far-reaching plans. But really, the movie starts properly with the supermarket bloodbath, right, Donnie?
Oh yeah,
this is a good cool opening. It takes you, it pulls you right in. I mean, that's canon for you. They had some hell of a good openings.
Oh yeah,
I mean, well, they had not just openings. I mean, I love their big films all the way through. But I mean, but they do have to draw you in.
A lot of their movies, you know, over the scope of the movie, may not make a massive amount of sense, but you're going to have fun, right? That's one of the calling cards of canon. It's like, look, you know what? We make up for plot holes with fun. You're going to enjoy some violence and gore. That's what you sign up for. And you want to see Stallone, you know, just killing people left and right. You're going to get it. And even here, like, they're going to grab you by the ass because it's like, all right, well, you know, this thing's violent as fuck right out the gate. This dude comes into a supermarket and just starts
shot.
And just randomly blowing everybody away with a shotgun. Then
even shopping carts. Even shopping carts getting blown up. Boom, and everywhere.
Yeah, I like the one where he lets the guy, like, you can go, man, you're free. And then as soon as the guy starts to walk down the aisleway, he just blows him away into a Christmas tree.
Yeah.
And then Cobra comes in and has to kick some ass. But you get lines. Oh, you get plenty of one-liners. And this is where you get, you're a disease, and I'm the cure. Wasn't it right after that, too, where he's like, no, maybe that was where he was confronting the guys in the street. Now, number one, I think he was kind of being the asshole aggressor there. Remember, there was like some guys sitting there in their car, kind of minding their own business, and because he wants to park there.
Oh, yeah.
Because he wants to park there, fuck you, and like just pushes their car out of the way. And then like, I think that's where he says, like, something's bad for your health.
Yeah,
this takes, is bad for your health.
What is? Mouth and then he, yeah, t-shirt.
Bad for your health. What is me?
And he rips and then, his shirt.
Yeah, and just rips his fucking shirt and just leaves him like a bitch. Just stand. Fuck you. And then later on in the movie, there's the callback to it, right? Like when he rolls up, they just move out of the way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just Cobra just swinging his dick around everywhere. One of the more memorable things about this movie is that knife that the Night Slasher has. Now, apparently, like, Stallone had that, like, specifically made. Like, he went to some dude that makes, like, you know, I guess badass knives or something. He's like, yeah, make a memorable, awesome knife. And I think he achieved that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's got that not like brass knuckles, but it's got the thing, the guard that goes across the knuckles with spikes on it, right?
Yeah.
And then blade.
I remember even watching this once again. I probably shouldn't have been watching this as a kid, but I remember watching this as a kid thinking, like, holy shit, that knife is awesome. Like, man, you could really do some damage with that knife, because not only stabbing people, but you could just punch them in the face and they're, you know, like you said, it's like brass knuckles with spikes as the handle of the blade. And then the blade itself is like one of the, what do they call that type of blade, Donnie? Like a duck, kind of like a duck. What are they, duck bill or something like that? There's a certain type of
edge to
that blade, but it's kind of a curved. It's not a normal looking blade or knife at all, right? The whole thing. I'm not a knife.
I'd butcher it. Yeah,
I'm not a knife aficionado, but I know enough to know that thing's awesome. you could do some serious damage with it, and he does quite a bit in this movie. But
speaking of awesome weapons, Marion Cobretti's gun, which obviously is going to have a cobra on it, right? Yeah, on the handle, on the pearl handle. I guess it's pearl. It's white handle, white inlaid handle with a cobra on it.
Yeah.
then he doesn't bother sticking it in a holster at all, I don't think. He just sticks it in his waistband, right?
Yeah, and then later remember later on in the movie, too, he has like some kind of like modified fucking Uzi or whatever the hell that thing was with the lasers, with the laser sight on it.
So two badass guns he's got.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you were as badass as Cobra, you'd have these guns too, Smoke.
Oh yeah, and he's got the perfect aviator sunglasses too. I don't know if they made those specifically for this movie, but they reflect blue and
yeah,
they're just the most 80s of aviator glasses you've ever seen.
And as you should, he wears them at the worst times too. Like even when he's at home by himself, he's wearing these fucking sunglasses.
Gun battles at the very beginning of the movie, for instance, with we talked about the you know, the thugs inside the supermarket.
Yeah,
he's got sunglasses on in there.
Yeah, when they're unwieldy and you probably shouldn't be wearing sunglasses, he's wearing these sunglasses.
Does he ever take them off? I'm trying to remember.
He does. Yeah, there are certain moments. Like I remember the one in particular when he goes into the house after he just punked out those dudes in the alleyway. And he sits down to, like, I guess he's going to clean his gun, and he's got all of his shit in an old egg carton. And he turns the TV on, and there's that Toys R Us commercial playing. And then it cuts to the news. That's when he takes his that was one moment that I remember him taking the sunglasses off. Like, oh, this is a serious moment. The sunglasses have to come off. Not because I'm alone in my house and nobody knows that I'm being cool right now. No, I need to take these off because, speaking of cool, you get the Angel of the City montage. This is where
The first thing of that struck me is the robots. I'm like, why the hell are there random?
Yeah, what the fuck? And then
you finally get why.
As you're watching it, though, like there should have been at least one establishing shot of what the fuck the robots were, right?
Yeah.
Because it's just cutting to Stallone and his partner, Gonzalez, in the streets questioning people, trying to find out what's going on here. The song Angel of the City. Yeah. And then it just cuts to a toy robot. And you're like, what the fuck? And then it just keeps doing it until eventually you realize that the main girl that witnesses the murder, Ingrid, she's doing a photo shoot. And for some reason in this photo shoot, there's a bunch of like robots that she's posing with. 80s, right? Fucking 80s, man. Going back to Rocky IV, what is it with the Stallone and the robots here?
Oh, good call.
Just wait till if you want to, you know, something to do with toy robots and action movies, wait till we get to something like Ninja Terminator.
I think this is one of the highlights of the movie is where they go, the killers go to kill Ingrid because she has witnessed, you know, she has seen their face. So that's really the rest of the movie, right? Is them trying to get her because she can ID the Night Slasher. But when they first go to attack her and they're in that parking garage, and then that security guard comes out of like the elevator or whatever the fuck, and he's just shooting at him, and then they ram that motherfucker through a wall with that van.
Yeah.
And I do believe, I might be mistaken, but I saw somewhere where there was a couple of stunt guys that got like really bad hurt ramming a car, like intentionally ramming a car into the wall. So that's the only moment when I saw that. I'm like, well, that has to be where it happened. Apparently, like, one dude got seriously hurt just ramming that fucking van into the wall like that. You get a pretty, you know, as any good action flicks too, you get a really good car chase here, right?
Oh, yeah. With the 50 Mercury.
Yeah. Boy, they beat the shit out of that car too before. Like, wouldn't that thing just have died well before it did? Like, those jumps that they're making and the thing kept landing, like, front, like, landing on its front and then falling down, like, a number of times. I just thought of the Dukes of Hazzard, right? Like, they had to have run through. Like, there's no way these cars survived these. Like, boom, that's dead. Next, boom, that's dead. It would beat the shit out of them when they're doing those little bunny hop, you know, over those small hills. I don't think it would survive that.
Yeah, hell yeah. Just jumping and this wasn't in San Francisco, but just, you know, like this, the Bullet, like the movie Bullet with Steve McQueen in San Francisco.
Yeah.
You take any of those, and I've been in San Francisco, but you take any of those hills at a certain speed, your car's done for, just one jump like that. So, yeah, I'm sure they had to go through quite a few of the Mach 1950. I don't know that they actually bought any actual 1950s, or they just made a mock-up body, some other chassis, I assume. But, I mean, that would have been a hell of an expense to go through beating the shit out of, you know, 5, 6, 7 1950 Mercuries.
Yeah, I think from what I read, it was they had the one that Stallone had, and then the rest were all just like, all right, let's take some Ford Pintos and then, you know, put a fake Mercury body on top of it.
What was that movie we watched? I want to say it was, it was a Cannon movie as well. I want to say it was Braddock, maybe, where they the cars were already burned out, yeah, and they were just beating on them with sticks.
That was Missing in Action 2, I think. Yeah.
Oh, God.
No. It was the third one. It was part 3, where they were going back to the fall of Saigon.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
They're already burnt out, and they're just beating them, just wailing on them.
The other, the lady cop that's with them that like kind of gets put there, they kind of gets put there on purpose. Her name is Nancy. She turns out to be a rat, but you see that coming a mile away, right? They don't hide that. It just happens that she's a fucking rat. Then I like too when Gonzalez is shot. You know, like in kind of basically like one of the final little battles with the new world that they have. Gonzalez gets shot and they just kind of leave him for dead. He does make kind of a half-hearted attempt, like, you know, Gonzalez, where are you? And then they just hop in the truck and take off. You know, it turns out, he was shot, but he's all right. But I just like that they just basically just left his ass like, well, he'll be all right. Come on. How about the one guy? Where one of the goons confronts him and he says, "You have the right to remain silent." Just pours gasoline all over him and lights him up. I said, fuck, man!
He didn't remain silent. He was blazing in fire. Well,
you know, just because you have the right don't mean you need to exercise it, I guess. I love the monologue from the Night Slasher where he just says "pig" 1,000 times.
These are the reasons we do this, pig. Isn't that right, pig?
That was one of the more memorable things of this movie, too, from seeing it 1,000 times, is joking about the pig line.
Yeah, I remember them saying something about they didn't think that guy was going to be right for the role because he was too nice.
Yeah.
Until he, you know, started getting into character and doing it. And they're like, okay, yeah, he's right.
Yeah, yeah.
He does not like.
No, I guess he was just his attitude is he was nice.
Yeah, but he's probably one of those dudes that like is the nicest dude in the world if you met him face to face. But like his look, he definitely looks like a fucking, you know, serial killer.
That's probably what it was too. Like he's just talking to them all like, yeah, you know, like his best friend or whatever. Then like, could you read this line for us? And then he got right into that. And he's like, oh, okay, yeah, you're good.
But that's where the Night Slasher is. Where the Slasher is challenging him, like you can't. You can't murder me because murder's still against the law, isn't it, pig? And he keeps saying that. And then that's when Cobra says the line, This is where the law stops and I start, sucker. I don't know about you.
I think I read that was a line, that line from that was going to be in Beverly Hills Cop script that he wrote.
Yeah, probably
or something.
I don't know about y'all though, but when he said that, I got up and gave a standing ovation. I had to pause the movie and I clapped for 5 straight minutes. Then once I calmed down, I sat back down and hit play and watched the rest of the movie. But you know, of course, you have the inevitable final showdown with the Night Slasher. They fight for like 10 minutes, and then it eventually ends with him hanging him on a hook that's in this foundry. And by the way, I think that was an actual working foundry that they shot that in. So it was like 1,000 degrees in there. But he hangs the Night Slasher on a hook and then sends him through an incinerator and lights his ass on fire. But then you had, you know, as all 80s movies go, like you had to have the rebel cop punch the straight-laced cop in the face to kind of end the movie, right? The guy that's been giving him shit the whole movie, you know, he basically gives him the old fuck you and then punches him, you know, doesn't like knock him out, just kind of leaves him standing up, punches him, and then he grabs, you know, the arm of Ingrid and walks away. The end. That's Cobra. So now, you know, I did see where, and maybe this could have been director's cut. I'm not sure where I saw this at, like where this existed, but apparently one of the original versions, I guess, of the way this was supposed to end was that asshole Detective Monty, mm-hmm. was supposedly supposed to be the brains behind the New World. Like in the end, it was going to be like, no, the Night Slasher wasn't, the old double cross kind of thing. Like, oh, you think you think you've won. It wasn't the Night Slasher that was the brains behind the outfit. It was this guy. And, you know, then I guess there would have been some showdown there. But apparently, I guess they decided to go with the ending that they went with. But that could have been interesting, right, Donnie?
Yeah.
All right. So there was a brief pause there because Donnie had to step away. But he did, before he stepped away, and since we're about to get into the ratings, I'll go ahead and let you know that he gave this 4 cannonballs out of 5. Now, we rate this a slightly different way because we're comparing it to other canon movies, right? We're not comparing this to Godfather or Gone with the Wind or, you know, the epic movies of all time, but we're comparing this to other canon movies. So he gives us 4 cannonballs. So that's a good, I think 4 cannonballs is a good place to start. So Smoke, we'll go with you. What are your final thoughts on Cobra, and what's your cannonball rating?
I love this one. This is one of my favorite canons. Also love it because, as I mentioned before, it plays out like the slasher movie. I mean, I would really love to see that X-rated cut,
yeah.
You know, the X-rated for the violence and gore. But even without that, it's pretty brutal anyhow. Yeah. A lot of great one-liners, as we've talked about. Stallone, top-notch canon, at least, if not, I mean, whether you think this is top-notch Stallone, you know, yeah, like his first Rocky movie, the second, the third, you know, there's a lot of other things out there. But, I mean, if you are a canon fan, you know, it's top-notch Stallone, for sure. The soundtrack, yeah, I unironically love the soundtrack. This movie, or most canon films and the most I don't think, I'm going to have to go with 5 cannonballs on it.
Yeah, and honestly, I'm not going to disagree. I mean, like, I could see where Donnie says 4, you know, like, it isn't to some people as good as, say, Over the Top or a few, you know, like, some of our top ones so far have been Over the Top, Invasion USA, the first Missing in Action, and Ninja 3, The Domination, right? We all love that one. Those have been some of our higher rated ones. This one, to me, is right there. Like,
oh, yeah.
You know, it maybe for different reasons, it's not quite as good as some of those I just mentioned, but for other reasons, it's just as good to me. You're getting prime 80s action flick action here, you know, like in your mind, when you think of an 80s action flick, this is one of those ones I think would probably come to mind, right? Like top 5, top 10 type 80s over the top type wacky. Definitely. In a lot of ways, violent action flicks. This is one of them. So, yeah, I agree with you, Smug. I'm going to go 5 cannonballs. Tiana, that leaves us to you. What do you say?
I really like this one, too. I guess you could probably say it was a popcorn flick action film.
Oh, yeah.
The only thing I don't like about it, now that I know there is an extra longer one out there, is I feel like it was kind of chopped a little bit.
Yeah, and it was. I mean, it was edited multiple times from what we see here, so... Just knowing that there is 30 or 40 minutes to cut out of this, it probably would have made more sense. Forget the gore and violence, right? It probably would have made more sense.
Yes. Because like I said earlier, I was like, why is there a gang that's, you know.
Yeah, I would imagine some of that stuff they cut out probably would have explained their motivations a little bit better. You know, you would think.
I think also, though, back then, even if they, even without the gore, let's just say, don't even think about the gore being cut out of it, just the fact that it was, went from being however long that cut was down to an hour and, what is it, hour and a half?
Hour 27,
yeah. So I think Golan and Globus themselves would have said, hell no, we're not putting out this long of a movie. Nobody wants to sit through this long of an action movie. We're going to chop it down. That's probably what happened.
They just
went back and chopped down some of that stuff that really would have explained some things, because to make the pacing that much, you know, quicker.
I totally agree, and you're probably right on some level, but on another level, they're probably also too so happy to have Sylvester Stallone. They're just like, whatever you want to do.
Yeah, true.
Because let's face it, they didn't get a lot of dudes on his level at Cannon. They really didn't. I mean, you could argue Chuck Norris and Charles Bronson. That's about it, right?
Yeah.
But I'm going to give it 4 Cannonballs.
Yep. Not going to argue it. So that, without Will's 2 cents and Austin too, you know, without figuring his number in, that leaves us at 4.5 Cannonballs. So we highly recommend it. If you haven't watched it, you know, we've spoiled it for you, but we really haven't spoiled anything in terms of, like, you just need to witness it yourself. The storyline wise, it's simple 80s cut and dry, really, at its core. You know, you just need more explanation as to why, what's their motivation? Why the hell are they doing this? Other than, really, you just come to the conclusion they're doing this for violence sake, right? So, but I think if you just want over the top 80s action, you're going to get it in spades here. So, we highly recommend Cobra. Go check it out. It's available in, you know, various formats, Blu-ray, DVD, all that jazz, VHS, and I'm sure it's streaming in various places. So go check it out. We highly recommend it. So that is it as far as, this week is concerned. Donnie had the jet, like I said, so he didn't leave his Cannon connection, so we'll just move on without that. Although I'm sure there probably was a few connections that you could easily make here with some of the cast that was in this. And, well, and of course, over the top, right, with Stallone, so there's that. I was just thinking of one directly. That's an easy one, so there's that. But anyways, next week, we're going to it's going to be my turn in the rotation, and we're going back to a well that we haven't got to dip into as much as we would probably like, or at least Smoke and I would have liked. And we're going to go to the Italian horror, and we're going to go with Gates of Hell, aka what is it? What's the other title?
Oh yeah,
the one that's more known, I guess, these days. What's it called? I'm blanking. City of Living Dead. Is that what it is?
Yeah, the one that's actually, I mean, the full Italian title was like Paura nella città dei morti viventi, which means fear in the city of the living dead, and then it was just usually shortened to City of the Living Dead in some places, in some markets. But when they re-released it on DVD and Blu-ray, it was mainly as City of the Living Dead. Yeah. VHS, you know, VHS renters back in the day knew it as Gates of Hell, but that big box Paragon video release with the skull on the front of it, that very iconic, you know, airbrushed 80s horror artwork.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Awesome poster. You'll probably find it easier if you're digging around these days as City of the Living Dead. But like he said, you know, a lot of people are going to know it as the Gates of Hell. So you might find it as either title when you're going around to find it. And as of the recording of this, it looks like it is available to watch on Pluto TV and Tubi. And of course you can rent it, buy it, whatever, if you don't own a copy of the movie in this. And I do believe, if I'm not mistaken here, Smoke, correct me if I'm wrong, this is the first Lucio Fulci.
Mm-hmm.
Because we did Zombie, but that was on, no, you know what? No.
Grindhouse.
Yeah. That was on Grindhouse Gutter. So on the podcast proper, I think this is the first Fulci, right?
Definitely is. Yeah, I think we've only done one Argento film. Well, I mean, Suspiria. Argento as a director, you know, Lamberto Bava's Demons, Argento produced and had a big hand in anyways. But really, yeah, that not, and beyond that, I can't think if we did any other Italian ones.
Other than Django, right? Well, that was a spaghetti Western.
Django, we did do that on Cult Corner.
I think that was Cult Corner. That was podcast proper. But other than that, I think you're right. So, yeah, if nothing else, it's going to be awesome just to get some of that. Because, you know, we have a mixed result from everybody when we do these things with Suspiria and Demons and, you know, and the other things that we've kind of done in the periphery. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting for those reasons alone. And if it just turns out to be, say, the three of us doing it, then we'll all be happy, right? At least we'll be happy watching City of the Living Dead again. So,
yeah.
For Will and Donnie, Tiana, Professor Smoke, I'm Josh. We are the All-American Spook Show, and come back next week for City of the Living Dead.